Well, it's always a big deal taking a look at the power sector in terms of the issues to focus on. But, well, we'll see what, how far or much of that we can focus on here this morning. We've got O'Neill Olajuwomi, who is the CEO of Wavelength Integrated Power Services. Thank you for coming on this morning.
Thank you, Chamberlain, for having me.
Well, having seen that report yesterday where FEC did approve an extension of CBN intervention fund for power generating companies, which is going to be another form of, you know, getting the GenCos funds. Now, that's particularly for the GenCos.
Yeah.
You know, but those who haven't seen that, on the one hand, it may appear good, but some looking at it think, wait a minute, is this not rewarding bad behavior in the sense that the discos are supposed to generate funds to pay the GenCos? So if they can't meet up with that obligation and FG is intervening and giving GenCos funds, what's the guarantee that, how do you ensure that discos must always fulfill the obligations to the GenCos?
Sure, yeah, you're quite correct. I mean, you can look at a glass half full of, or half empty, so to speak. And when the Honorable Minister Zainab Ahmed did mention that 600 billion naira has been approved, earmarked as a second tranche of the Nigeria Electricity Market Stabilization Facility, specifically going for the GenCos. But in this time, the payment is actually an obligation of the federal government. So it's a loan the federal government is going to be paying back to CBN. It's very, very important to kind of send the message out to the public and also the market participants that intervention fund is not free money. It's not grant. It has to be, it's a palliative, it has to be paid back.
But the GenCos have said, look,
let's clear that
we don't have money.
Quite all right. Yeah, you're very true.
I mean, pay back.
Let me try to remind us, and perhaps some of us watching might actually get angry at this point in time. It's pre-privatization, $16 billion was spent on electricity. I remember the president mentioned in February that was going to be probing that. Yeah, I mean, that's pre-privatization. Now, 2009, there was the Power Sector Innovation Intervention Fund, $300 billion was set aside. And that was those monies were actually used. Then in 2014, you had $213 billion, the Nigerian Electricity Market Stabilization Facility, which is the first tranche, all right? That is expended. 2017 and 18, you have $701 billion, all right? Again, going as payment assurance guarantee to the power sector. I know we're talking about 600 billion, billion naira. The issue of the matter is that Albert Einstein was widely acclaimed to say that you can't keep doing the same thing. The definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result. I mean, it's just, it doesn't make any sense. It's going to be a vicious circle. Let's put it that way. But back to what Chamberlain did mention. Yeah, the discos are saying they don't have money. And it's true. For example, Ibadan Disco was in the news at some point. They couldn't pay their 5 billion naira that was assessed through in this intervention fund. And the next stepped in to suspend the staff, but that was reversed back because they said, okay, let's give them a second chance. You have insinuations that these discos are actually warehousing money in the bank as some sort of deposit money to get interest. But that is not interesting to me at this point in time and not to Nigerians. We want electricity. What do we do about it? Of course, the truth of the matter is that I'm not apologetic about being a patriotic Nigerian. I am patriotic. If not, I'd have run to Canada by now. The country is crazy, but some of us have to stay back to try and see what we can do.
What guarantee
now
is there that this 600 will give us electricity? That's what people want to know.
The guarantee is we're not going to get 24 hours electricity by intervention fund, so there's no guarantee. But what this guarantee is going to do is to kind of increase investors' confidence in coming, increase investors' confidence in coming into the power sector.
Now,
Eugene Mohammed, right, the TCN a boss, MD, who have an interaction with a fantastic gentleman, did mention that the PHCN, the discos, 11 in all, will need about $4.3 trillion investment. That's one more of a capitalization, whatever you call it, to match up the investment being done in the TCN at this point in time. So these guys are not credible.
Even though there's an argument too against TCN.
Yeah, of course, you can look at that.
If they have their own power to Sagamu, for instance, and you don't have the transmission to get it there, then there's be a problem, because some say, if you look at the last, or what do you call it, the in the last 6 months, the investment in the TCN era, it's been to a particular area. So if some of the industrial areas don't have those facilities to get power to those areas, you can't have any power supply in that regard. But on the point, the issue you raised about this going to give investors confidence to come into the market, how is that going to be? Because if the big question of tariff has not been addressed, what confidence are you giving?
Well, first of all, we look at the $701 billion is a payment assurance guarantee. And that guarantee is some sort of, it's likened to the partial risk guarantee, the PRG that the World Bank and the AFDB gives. That's our local PRG.
Yeah.
And that is two greenfield projects to kind of back up greenfield projects that, look, if we don't, if your power purchase agreement is not honored by the Nigerian Bulk Electricity Trading Company, which is an entity set up in the TEM, Transitional Electricity Market, you know, we will pay you. All right? So if any investor is coming, it's just like you going to a bank and the bank saying, okay, what's your collateral? You want loan. So bank, the Nigerian government is stepping in, all right, for the investors and saying, look, we guarantee payment. You have to understand that it's a value chain. The gas sector is badly affected by the GenCos not remitting the funds.
We need to talk about appropriate pricing in the gas area.
And then you're looking at the GenCos. The DISCOs are not actually meeting up their invoices to MBET. So MBET cannot pay the GenCos. I think the last time I checked, about 35% that the DISCOs are performing.
Are the GenCos the problem? Because
I don't think so.
We understand, the minister came out to say that we have this 7,100 megawatts of electricity that we have. And then 2,000 of that is still being waited to be uptaken by the Manufacturers Association of Nigeria.
I wasn't in that stakeholder.
Now you talk about investors coming into the frail. How then do you justify investors coming in if what you have you're unable to send out?
Well, you have to look at it this way, right? The electricity sector is 40. The structural formation of the privatization is 40 ab initio, all right? I said it, and I'm going to repeat. I'm unapologetic, a patriotic Nigerian. I'm not apolitical, but I think this government is doing fantastically well. I'm in the sector. I'm in the sector pre-privatization, so I've been in here about 10 years. I know what I'm talking about. There's a lot going on in the background that you need to see, especially in the side of the Rural Electrification Agency. You can see what is going on if you're looking at the positive side of things. The 600 billion naira earmarked is to pay back on the defaulting PPAs, all right? That's the best a government can do to show that the Nigerian government is credible. So for once, I'm going to give them an applause. But is it going to solve the problem of power availability like you mentioned? No, absolutely no. We have to start looking at issues. Chamberlain mentioned tariff. You did mention tariff.
It's a big
question. I'm of the opinion of cost-reflective tariff.
Reflective tariff.
Cost-reflective
tariff. Cost-reflective tariff.
All right? For example, the MITRE 2 tariff, you need to factor in the inflation rate. You need to factor in the forex.
So let me ask you.
Sorry.
Pardon me.
Kind of different tangent, but I think it's a bit essential. Isn't this whole thing supposed to be privatized?
Yes.
Because, I mean, you've talked about some 701 billion naira. Some 600 billion naira, 213
billion naira,
and all of that,
billion naira,
you know, and then some 16
billion US dollars
previously. You
don't know where
that
went.
Now, this whole arrangement is supposed to say, okay, you know what, let the private sector come in.
Yeah.
We're talking about Trancos, Gencos, and first of all, isn't privatization supposed to make it a business? So why does government need to put in money in it?
We keep forgetting that it's an arrangement between the federal government and the private sector, the DISCOs precisely. The federal government still has 40% of the DISCOs, all right? Even though the DISCOs have 60% and they're supposed to be operators. So the federal government still has a say, all right? So the federal government coming into the show.
So the federal government is investing in?
Well, it's kind of like, not investing per se, kind of loaning money to the sector, hoping that they'll get the money back. But my fear is that those monies may not be paid back. Those monies may just put a dent into the balance sheet of the federal government,
so
and then we'll be in debt.
It's looking like some kind of subsidy?
Well, it's not, you can call it a palliative, A subsidy, yes, you can look at it, subsidized interest rates, single digit loan, you can look at it in that way. But of course, if you want to look at also the market obligation of the federal government, truth be told that some of the subvention was supposed to be on the tariff, subvention in the sense of subsidy we're talking about, and they've not met that. So the federal government is faulty in that aspect. But the DISCOs have not been meeting the payment, the full obligation, the payment to the embed. So that negates that, kind of like nets it off.
So fundamental problem with DISCOs again.
They're the weakest link.
Now,
so to say, I mean, I'm very sorry to say, I know I have friends in the DISCO. I have a very good friend of mine who is a director in the DISCO.
So does that mean that the problem is not with the GenCos? So why fund the GenCos?
Well, you have to fund the GenCos, but GenCos have actually invested money, all right, to develop their power plants with a threshold assumption that the DISCOs will offtake power from them. All right?
You have all that is still waiting.
No, the powers, the DISCOs are actually rejecting power.
This plan, do you think it's going to work?
And let me tell you,
the
DISCOs are actually rejecting power as we speak.
Why?
So, because they cannot sell. They cannot get the revenue. And that is why we also need the government intervention to step up into revenue collection. Back
that
to
takes us to the tariff.
Yeah, it takes us to the tariff.
Speaking about the tariff, which you say, I mean, which is a big challenge.
Yeah.
And the thing about the tariff is this. For instance, if you look at the telecom sector, the NCC regulates those telcos. The NCC can see when they do their KPI, NCC sees the drop calls and all of those that happen in that sector. If you go to the CBN can see when certain things hit CBN server, so CBN can also see some of these figures that the banks also have. Mm. But when we come to the power sector, does the NERC have that capacity? Because if they're asking for their data, isn't it the DISCOs that give NERC data upon which they take that decision? So if the regulator is the one giving the regulator the data, how are you going to get appropriate tariff?
Yeah, I mean, you have a very good point. But remember that the NERC's role, like you mentioned, is regulatory. There's little or more they can do other than make sure that all the rules are being laid out. Mm-hmm. And for example, In that kind of mitigating the problems we're facing, the quagmire we're in right now in the power sector, there were recently the MAP meter access program was recently launched, and that was to kind of improve revenue collection, which is a major problem of the DISCO.
Yeah, but
for
the example, question is, the DISCO's, my apologies,
aren't
we missing the point or beating about the bush? If the regulator don't have the capacity to determine, because if the DISCO is coming and say, look, our pricing is not right for the tariff, mm-hmm. how do we prove? Because if most of data that comes from them on tariff is estimated, they can't tell us that, look, this amount of data goes to
industrial areas, this
goes to residential area. If we can't distinguish all of those, how do we, you know, justify the integrity of data that comes from the DISCOs?
I mean, it's really a terrible situation we are in the power sector. I'm hoping that at some point we'll be able to get 24-hour power. But for now, it's looking like a mirage, so to speak. But back on your question of the data being related back from the DISCO and also the transmission company, I'd like to let you know, for example, the TCN, headed by Eugene Mohammed, the loss indices. On the line loss indices are assumed. They're not scientifically proven. So the indices
are not estimation.
So therefore, that's wrong. I've been issued even from the transmission company. The data are wrong, but we know that, all right? The DISCOs know that. The DISCOs' argument is that, look, they bought an asset that they didn't know what they were going in for.
Oh.
You know, and that was my argument, one of the directors, like, look, who buys an asset and you didn't do your due diligence? But all that being said and done, we know the problem. What we're looking for is a way forward. And the way forward is to kind of boost the revenue collection of the DISCO so that they can
Which
be liquidity
from tariff.
From tariff. I mean,
how
the tariff collection.
The revenue,
not the tariff. We agree that the tariff needs to be cost reflective. I mentioned that MITRE 2 tariff needs to be revisited. All right. The inflation rate needs to be considered. The gas price increase needs to be considered. And the foreign exchange indices need to be considered, but that does not kind of guarantee that the DISCOs will be able to collect the revenue from the consumer. So, for example, you see the issue of estimated billing
is
still going. That is what you just said. it's a tariff, you know, like what it's on the tariff. The tariff is what you pay, all right? But then the whole cumulative bill of a customer is being estimated. So it's not definite. Again, estimated billing, because the customers have now lacked, you know, they've lacked trust in the discourse. They're not paying up. They're like, oh, look, I was in an estate just around, not far off. We're invited as a private company to come and look at it. They're worried, you know, like they have their own blended power, diesel and PHCN, and they worry because the bill is up and down. They have to go and buy their own check meter to check the discos.
What was the success rate of administering the prepaid meters?
It's been less than 10%.
That's abysmal.
So that means
abysmal.
We can. That means we're way.
There was, this is the second. I mean, there was capping.
Justifying why people should be paying for estimated bills.
I think there was a pronouncement at some point that estimated billing should, if you're given estimated billing and then you're not met up within some point, some months, and then you shouldn't pay the bill. The law of pronouncement has not been followed. You know, I share the passion of the current structure in the power sector, and I'm telling you this because I've had a discussion with the minister. I've been fortunate to have a discussion with Fashola at some point, and I can see the passion in this man. I was at the 2000, the first one. This is not the current one.
This
first stakeholder meeting, the manufacturer association of Nigerian stakeholder. I was there. It was a little room, and then we deliberated with the DISCO MDs and whatnot on the way forward. People are trying to do good things, you know, but then we're being frustrated because there's a structural problem. I've been issued. We need to press reset.
Now, good. In pressing reset, you have identified, and I'm sure it's something that's probably globally, you know, agreed upon in the entire sector.
Sure.
The DISCOs as the weakest link.
Yeah.
Ultimately, mm-hmm. it's about consumption.
Mm-hmm.
Good. How do we press reset on what is distributed and how it is, you know, consumed and paid for? Because if people consume without paying, you can't blame them if you can't.
That was what the minister was saying this morning. Circumvention. People are circumventing, you know.
So how do you?
Yeah, how you intend to do that is for the government or more investors to come into the sector. When I mean government, think about recapitalization, all right? Perhaps the government bring in 40% of their own money, all right? Find a way to sell the DISCO to credible investors, the investors who can pull in cash. There's a lot of challenge. You're talking about transmission problem, with a distribution problem within the DISCO. You're talking about the equipment problem. A few days ago, I mean, Siemens just mentioned that we're going to try to assist Nigeria. Nigeria talking to Siemens on improving the DISCO equipment, the distribution equipment. Last week, I mean, every week in my office, I call the DISCO manager, the manager of the co-distribution company in my area, telling them, oh, the transformer has gone off, you know, the lines are clicking and whatnot, come and reset them. And they know these problems.
But
they
don't have enough money. Isn't there over-centralization?
There's no liquidity in the sector, which is the major problem. They cannot invest in improving their network. They cannot invest in meters. Buying meters, which is why the government came up with a meter access program.
When you then say that the DISCOs are the weakest link, the DISCOs have consistently argued that no, we can't say that we are the weakest link because they can only function, for instance, to the extent that the GenCos allow them to.
Well, I don't think that is correct. I don't think that's not correct. The GenCos, let's just leave the GenCos out of this, all right? Because
why?
Because the GenCos, they're facing a whole lot of problems. They're getting the backlash. The GenCos are the ones that generate the power. They have to pay. They have an
GSPA. They did not we don't have any load from GenCos, so we can't distribute what we don't have.
No, they are rejecting load.
How would they be in this?
Last year, you heard about how the governor was in a fracas, a fight with the Benin
DISCO. That case is a different case.
I'm telling you. Let me tell you. I'm very sympathetic with the DISCO. You know, because I'd be very damned, excuse my language, if I was that kind of person that had gone to buy a car. Imagine somebody has sold you a car in an auction.
We need to go to break. But maybe we'll take it from that point, because a lot of people can understand if they sell you a car. Especially if it's not a good car, then they will raise your heavens. Okay, we'll take it from there. We'll come back in a moment. Stay with us. Okay, welcome back. It's our concluding moments now. Talking about your analogy, could you continue from if you sell a bad car?
Yeah.
To someone.
Yeah, it's a case of an auction. You get into an auction, all right? You buy a car, you see buy as sin, and then you didn't even make any attempt to go even because online and just check if you know, this car has been stolen or accidental somewhere, you buy that car, it's your problem. So the discos are saying, look, we bought this power asset without looking, being allowed into the data room. Whose fault is it, really? I mean, why would I buy something? Like I said in my first interview, that was in 2017, yeah, they saw it as a jamboree. You know, I'm sorry, it's just as a jamboree. Although there are a few discos performing. For example, the Echo Disco. Echo Disco is performing. Ikeja Disco is performing quite well. But I'm sorry, apart from all those two discos, performing, I saw your face. I mean, they're trying to improve. They're improving because I'm in the sense of
telling
you this.
There's always improvements anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
So they're trying to improve.
But I feel their pain.
Know.
But at the end of the day, they've already bought in, thinking that, oh, this is a cash cow. But the boomerang, like, you know?
Isn't this
just boomerang?
Some kind of isn't there some kind of over centralization?
Yes.
But even with the federal government, because so many state governments want to come in, but you know, they're also kind
yeah,
of.
Yeah, you know, that this, and again, I'm going to take us back saying that the ab initio, the arrangement was 40. You know,
which
the privatization was 40 from onset. There are, for example, the discos have the monopoly to distribute to certain areas, which is what the federal government have been trying to break. And you know, look at the case of the Ariaria market. The Ariaria market, it just got power, you know, IPP over there. But this matter, you know, went into court, back and forth. Surah market in Lagos, back and forth. So if anybody attempts to come and give power, be it state government or whatever, come and give power to a cluster area, I mean, the discos will raise their heads and like, look,
so
we're taking you to court.
So why then feed a faulty structure when you know that there are other options that you could follow?
What other options?
I mean, if you have to go through the pre-1960
the only option,
you have newer technologies that you're going to
follow. Quite all right. You have newer technologies, renewable energy, for example.
So which consumers, which customers?
You are allowed to put renewable energy in your individual homes if you wish, all right. If you have a close gated estate, all right, you are allowed to generate your own power.
I thought part of
but
what
I
you were suggesting is
your street now and okay, come on.
That's what I was going because you can't
go to
the discos who say no, this is our area.
Yeah. So, but you know, if you live, I live in an estate with 24 hours power.
Okay. So in other words, you're suggesting there has to be a change of the power structure.
Yes, it has to be a reset. It's a reset button. And we're currently going to the reset button now. But I'll say again, the intervention fund will not guarantee us 24/7 power. If the reset button is not pressed, 24/7 power 24/7 power to Nigeria will be a mirage. You know, so
all right.
We'll
leave it at that point. O'Neill Lajuomi, CEO of Wavelength Integrated Power Services. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me. Good morning, Nigeria.
All right, so hold on. There you go. That's the show today. Thank you all for watching. We'll see you tomorrow. I'm Chamberlain Uso.
I'm Gimba Omar.
I am Akine here saying good morning.
Thank you.
And Maokwe Ogunstein, have a lovely day.
The views and opinions expressed by guests on this program are those of the maker and do not reflect the views, opinions, and endorsement of Channels Television.